Hello everyone, this is Debarco Gangudi, and today I have thought about doing something which was a bit impossible for me even quite a few days ago. But as the COVID-19 is challenging us to challenge our boundaries and stay within our limitations and still attain what was unattainable even a few days ago. You see, I wish Macbeth had thought about being in his boundaries and still attain the unattainable. Now, let's get into the text, okay? Now you see, the entire title of Macbeth is The Tragedy of Macbeth. Okay. Now, this is the title given by Shakespeare, not by me. Now, let us question the title itself. What is a tragedy? If we ask this question, we must think of tragedy as a genre, as a determining, a guiding factor for our understanding of the text. Now, there are many ways of addressing a tragedy, and if you go to College Street when the lockdown is gone, you can find multiple good books on tragedy. Especially one good book on tragedy is available by Clifford Litch. That's a very good book. And then you have F.L. Lucas and others as well, which are equally good. Alright. Now let's try to fathom our way through Macbeth. It's 5 o'clock in the morning and I have had a sleepless night, so I need my coffee to keep myself up and going. So, anyway. The term tragedy is a Greek term, alright, because you see all great art started from Greece, and I mean all great Western art started from Greece, and tragedy comes from two separate sources, two separate root words, alright. I have written everything down for you. I hope it is visible. One is tragos, T-R-A-G-O-S. And the other is idia, O-E-D-I-A. Alright. So, tragos means a goat and idia means a song. Alright. Now, what is this goat song or tragos idia that we are talking about? Okay. I'll just shift the camera so that you can see the copy properly. Wait a second. Why can't I shift? Alright. In any case, tragos and idia. So, goat song. There is some problem with my phone, I guess. I cannot simply shift the camera to the other side. Now, what is this goat song? Now, you see, there was a Greek god whose name was Dionysus. He was the god of song. He was the god of wine and revelry. Now, there was a festival in the honor of this god Dionysus where they would sacrifice a goat which was sacred to the god, and a certain person, the priest primarily, he would be at the center, and there would be a congregation of people who were called the chorus. Okay, and the chorus would ask certain questions to the priest, and the priest would return an answer, and that's the beginning of drama for you. Alright, and then it got more and more complex, as is the norm. Now, tragedy began from here. Tragedy started from here. So you see, from the very beginning, tragedy had certain great artists. For instance, Sophocles, Euripides, and Aeschylus, and later Seneca, and many pre-Shakespearean greats like Christopher Marlowe, and so on and so forth. But you see, the first person who actually spoke very distinctively about tragedy was none other than Aristotle. Now, Aristotle, in chapter 6 of his Poetics. Now, the Poetics is a very interesting text, you know, and you should read it. All of you should read it. There's a very cheap edition of the Poetics, and it's very easily available, and you can understand it very easily. The text is by Ingram Bywater, Ingram, Ingram Bywater, BY, then water, simple spelling. Now, in this book, it's a simple translation of the Poetics. Now, in Poetics chapter 6, Aristotle for the first time tried to define tragedy. I would not go into the definition, but I would try to break it apart into pieces so that it becomes easier for you to understand what is a tragedy. Alright. Now, I am not saying that Aristotle is the be-all and end-all when it comes to tragedy. Aristotle has defined tragedy. Isidore of Seville has defined tragedy. Much later, closer to our times, Hegel has defined tragedy. Nietzsche has defined tragedy. Jean Anouilh has defined tragedy. So there are multiple ways of looking at tragedy. But we take Aristotle to be our point, because our point of reference, because Aristotle is the first person who actually properly theorized what is a tragedy. Now there Aristotle says that tragedy is an imitation of an action. Alright, the Greek term that he uses is mimesis. M-I-M-E-S-I-S. What is mimesis? And you see, mimesis is one term which connects Aristotle to his guru, Plato. Now, Plato was against drama primarily on the ground that, you see, the world that we see around us, Plato believed that this world is not real. It's a copy. Copy of what? Now, Plato believed that in the universe, at a given point of time, there is a certain ideal world, and this world is simply a copy of that world, of that ideal world. So you see, Plato believed that this world is already a copy, and if you write anything about this world, now this world, I mean, that writing would be a copy of a copy. But imagine there is one major distinction, that is, when Plato and Aristotle were writing, they did not know about Aryabhatta. So they did not have the zero. So the first ideal world is number one, this world is number two, and the poet's writing is number three. So in the old versions of tragedy books, you see that this world is thrice removed. In the new versions, you see twice removed, because 0, 1, 2, both are correct. It just matters which system you take. Just like you can call it ground floor, you can call it first floor. In Bengali, we say Aktala. We do not say Matiktala. Right? Matiktala would become basement. So, you can take any system, doesn't matter. So, you can say thrice removed, twice removed. Now, Plato believed that mimesis is simply a copy, a vile copy. But Aristotle said no, there is some merit in mimesis as well. What kind of a merit? Aristotle believed that there is a distinction between mimesis and another term which he coined, which was mathesis. Alright. Now, what is mathesis? Mathesis is simple. By mathesis, Aristotle means doing. By mimesis, Aristotle means making. Okay. Now, what is the distinction? Imagine the first carpenter of the world who is making the first table, or say the bed, the first bed of the world or the first table of the world. Now, do you think that a carpenter has a model before him? Obviously no. So he has made a thing which is absolutely new. So that was a copy from the idea of a bed or a table or a bench, whatever. But imagine the second carpenter. He has had a formula, that is, if I have four legs and a top, that makes a table. Right? That's the basis of a table. But do you think there is a formula for poetry? Obviously no. I mean, no formula can teach you how to write poetry. So, therefore, what happens is that poetry, drama, or literature in any form, or art in any form, does not have a formula. So therefore, whenever we are going for art, we are going for something which is an absolutely new thing, since there is no formula. So what happens over here is that Aristotle says that poetry, art, all of these are making, these are mimesis, that is, these are recreations of given themes, given orders. But say carpentry, that's doing, you are redoing the same stuff. Alright, so that's the distinction. But Plato said that whenever I am, say, imagine for a moment that I am playing Macbeth. Alright. So Plato would object to that because I do not know Macbeth. How can I play Macbeth? This was Plato's objection, that in order to copy somebody else, I am forgetting who I am and I am not just doing justice to that person either. So, like there is a Hindi saying, kawa chala hans ki chal aur khud ki chal bhi bhul gaya. So the same thing happens over here. That was Plato's accusation. But Aristotle said something else. Aristotle said, no, I am not copying Macbeth. I am creating my version of Macbeth. That is, I do not know what was Macbeth's favorite food. I don't know what's Macbeth's favorite color. I don't know in which posture does Macbeth love to sleep. I don't. I don't know what does Macbeth do when he wakes up. Does he yawn? Does he lay in the bed for half an hour? I don't know. Then how can I properly copy the character of Macbeth? What I can do is, I can only try to give my version of how Macbeth would enact his role on the stage. That's also my version. So I am recreating the character of Macbeth on stage. That's it. So look, it's an imitation of an action. Alright. So not imitation of a character, but imitation of an action. So that's mimesis. Alright, compared to mimesis. Now number two is that Aristotle believed that tragedy had to be something spoudaios. S-P-O-U-D-A-I-O-S. Now what is spoudaios? This is a very difficult term to explain. Just like if you have to explain no kakima or ranga pishi, if you have to translate this in English, you can't say ninth auntie or red auntie. Even phulpishe moshai, flower uncle, doesn't make any sense. So you see, it's specific to a culture. And similarly, spoudaios is specific to the Greek culture and it does not have any proper English translation. Some have said grave and great, some have said noble and superior. But none of them is a proper translation. But we get the sense that is of great importance. Now, during Aristotle's times, people became of grave importance through two things. One is by birth, the second is by worth. If I am born in a noble family, I automatically become noble in Aristotle's time and even in Shakespeare's time. And also, if I prove myself worthy in battle or in craft or in art, I become spoudaios. Alright. Now look, Macbeth is noble by birth. Because Macbeth is the son of Sinel, he is the Thane of Glamis by Sinel's death, as he would tell us in Act 1, Scene 3. And Macbeth's worth is established in Act 1, Scene 2, where Macbeth is being compared to Mars, the god of war, the Greek god of war. He is being called Bellona's bridegroom. Bellona was the wife of Mars. He is being called Babe Macbeth, Noble Macbeth, Bellona's bridegroom. So it's already established that he is spoudaios. Now, Aristotle says that tragedy has to be in a dramatic medium and not in a narrative medium. Macbeth is a drama, that much we all know. Now, you see, he suggests, he does not say this, that there has to be a journey from good fortune to bad fortune. That is, there has to be a fall. Now, this fall, coincidentally, has been beautifully described by Geoffrey Chaucer. Chaucer writes, I'll quote, "Tragedy is seen to be a certain story that old books making of memory of a man in great prosperity is fallen into misery and endeth wretchedly." Now look, nowhere in the Poetics does Aristotle suggest that a character must die. But what happened was that during Aristotle's times, the playwrights and the dramatists that he watched all kind of killed their basic hero. The only exception that comes to mind is perhaps Oedipus, because Oedipus does not die in Oedipus Rex. And Marlowe explores this theme in his Tamburlaine the Great, where Tamburlaine does not die at the end of the first part. And even at the end of the second part, he does not die a tragic death. He dies of natural causes. So you see, Aristotle never suggests that the tragic hero must die. But it was a general norm that the Elizabethan playwrights kind of killed their tragic hero. It was a norm. I don't know why they interpreted it in this way, but they did. Macbeth dies, Hamlet dies, Julius Caesar dies, King Lear dies, Othello dies. If you are a tragic hero, you must die. But you see, this journey from good fortune to bad fortune does not take place due to some freak of destiny or some freak of fate. So no chance and coincidence is involved. So it's not like one day King Lear took a stroll and suddenly thunder fell on him and he died. It's never going to happen. Then that would not construct his tragedy. That would be an accident. But two things that Aristotle suggests. Number one is hamartia, H-A-M-A-R-T-I-A, and don't ever say hamartia because the Greeks could not pronounce T as S. Alright, S-H. So it's hamartia, not hamartia. And hubris. What is hamartia? What is hubris? Pick up any book and they kind of show you that hamartia is tragic error of judgment. Why would a character commit a tragic error of judgment? If you read the Greek text closely in the original, you realize that Aristotle was talking about a primary level of psychoanalysis. I'm not saying that he was a very Freudian character or a Lacanian character himself, but then he was talking about the psychoanalysis of his own time, if anything like that existed during his time. So what happens over here is that Aristotle is talking about an error of judgment, true, but then it is an error which is not simply suddenly that the character decides, chalo aaj kuch tufani karte hain, and suddenly he commits an error. It's not like that. It's an error generated by a limitation. You see, at this given moment, I have a psychological barrier and I can make certain errors based on that psychological barrier. For instance, 30 years ago in Bengal or in India, if a woman would wear jeans, then the entire society would get scandalized. But now look at you today. Nobody bulges an eye. Right? So, if 30 years ago, say a certain woman is going to get married into a family and the family does not choose her because she wears jeans. As simple as that. And later, say 5-6 years later, they kind of come to regret the decision. Because of their psychological limitations, they did not accept her back then. So that would be a hamartia. And imagine if that's a tragic character. So that would be a hamartia. And what is hubris? See, hubris is a tragic pride. You see, whenever even we make mistakes and somebody points that out, it's a blazing mistake and even you can see it. The first thing that strikes our mind is that I did 9 things right and this guy is pointing to the one thing which I did wrong. So I kind of take offense in that. So whenever these people find out that they have made a hamartia and that is being pointed out and they blazingly stick to their mistake out of a tragic pride, that becomes a hubris. Alright. But you see, hamartia comes with something which is very interesting. Here Aristotle gives us 2 more terms. Alright. One is anagnorisis, the other is peripeteia or peripety. What is anagnorisis and what is peripeteia? A-N-A-G-N-O-R-I-S-I-S. Anagnorisis is like a discovery. That is, you let the tragic hero discover for himself that, okay, you have made this mistake. And when the hero makes this discovery after his hubris is gone, he kind of tries to change the situation. This change, this alternation is called peripeteia, P-E-R-I-P-E-T-I-A. Alright. Now, this much is understood, I hope. If not, question me in the comment section. Now, what kind of a person is suited to be the tragic hero? You see, the first thing that strikes our mind is that why the spouda ears? Yes, you need to understand, during Aristotle's times, during Shakespeare's times, apart from the drama, there was no medium or mode of entertainment. They did not have Netflix and chill. So, what could they do? Say, you have had a quarrel with your mother and you have gone to watch a theater, and suddenly there you see a commoner like you having a quarrel with his own mother or her own mother. Is that interesting? You can think like, hey, I did this at home, why pay and watch the same thing over here? But imagine the king is having a quarrel with his mother. Oh, so the king also has a quarrel with his mother. Alright, so I am not special and the king is not unlike me. So you see, it was not a larger than life view. It was an intenser than life view. Imagine if Mukesh Ambani has a quarrel with his mother. You can feel like, okay, this guy is human like me. Maybe has a few more crores of rupees than I do. But still, this guy is as human as I am. He too has quarrels with his mother. Clear. So that was the purpose. So what kind of a hero is suited for this purpose? Now, Aristotle says, since the person has to go from good fortune to bad fortune, it cannot be a good guy. If it's a good guy and he falls from good fortune to bad fortune, you'd say, oh, then if I be too good, then I'll also suffer the same fate. That sends out the wrong message. And if it's a bad guy, you'll feel like Beshoche. Serves him right. And the poetic justice. So the guy cannot be too good, the guy cannot be too bad. He has to be in between. Intermediary character. Alright. But now look, here is too good, here is too bad. In between there's so much of space. That's for the dramatist to traverse. So Aristotle does not prescribe, he only says what he has seen. Now, what is the end of tragedy? The end of tragedy is catharsis. Catharsis was a biological term. Aristotle's entire family was of biologists, so he knew about it. But catharsis means a kind of purgation. You see, back then it was believed that through bloodletting, that is by cutting, making a small incision in your foot and letting away some blood, you can cure certain bodily ailments. So, and they believed that your emotions resided in your blood, and therefore it was a technique of letting some of your blood go and by that curing your ailment. And since all these basic emotions which we could not control, like fear, anxiety, anger, so these were better let off. So theater was seen as therapy for the first time. Alright, so this is basically the Aristotelian paradigm. In the next lecture, we will go into the text itself. Thank you so much.